Decomposition part 1. So this is the second component on an ecosystem. So coming about a decomposition, it is the formation of inorganic minerals from the organic matter, and this organic matter comes from the dead organism. And this inorganic substances includes materials such as water, carbon dioxide, nutrients, etc. These inorganic substances or minerals are used by the plants for their growth, and these plants are used by the heterotrophs for consuming energy. And the source for decomposition is the dead plant remains of leaves, barks, etc. And this is also called as detritus, which is the main source for the inorganic substances which are produced from the organic matter. Decomposition part 2. So decomposition is a breakdown of organic matter into inorganic substances, and this takes the source as the dead organic matter or the dead living organism, so which is also termed as the litter. And this litter takes the use of the rainfall and then starts decomposition, and half of the litter or a part of litter is accompanied with the surface runoff which is not comes under the decomposition process. The litter which undergoes decomposition is taken up by the soil. So the nutrients which are obtained by the decomposition process are taken up by the soil and which is used for the production of the biomass from the plants. The other thing which we have to deal about the soil is the soil is obtained by the withering of the rocks. So that is also mentioned here, and it also undergoes leaching, and this leached soil does not comes under the biomass production. So the soil takes up the nutrients and it gives the nutrients for the plants for their growth, and the biomass is produced, and after a lot of process it again undergoes littering which forms a litter, and this litter is again decomposed to form the nutrients, and the cycle goes on repeating. So this is how the decomposition reacts in the formation of the biomass in an ecosystem. Decomposition part 3. So what are all the factors which are used in the process of decomposition? So we have to check for different factors to go for the decomposition process, and those factors are given here, that is it depends on the climatic factors. So as we have seen in the previous diagrams, rainfall is main source for the process of decomposition of litter. So climatic factors plays an important role. And the next one is availability of detritus. So this is the organic matter which is available for the production of inorganic substances. And coming for the next one, it is an energy consuming process. So that the availability of energy must also be taken in care. And the next one is the temperature and the moisture level in the soil also plays an important role. So the temperature should be in the correct condition, and also the moisture content of the soil should be in the correct form. And the next one, warm and the moist condition favor decomposition. So moist condition is provided by the rainfall and the availability of the type of soil in which the litter is present. And also warm temperatures favor the decomposition. So these are all the factors which are responsible for the decomposition process. Steps of decomposition part 1. So we are going to see about the steps which are involved in decomposition, and there are 5 important steps which are responsible for the decomposition process. And the first one is fragmentation, second one is leaching, and then catabolism, humification, and then mineralization. So these steps are undergone to make the inorganic substances from the organic matter. So we'll see about these steps in detail in upcoming slides. Steps of decomposition part 2. So here we are going to discuss about the steps which are involved in decomposition process in detail. So the first process that is involved is the fragmentation. So fragmentation is the breakdown of organic matter into smaller particles, which in turn you can also tell it as detritus is breakdown into smaller particles. This is done by the organisms which are termed as detritivores. For example, earthworm. So, earthworm is used in the breakdown of organic matter to smaller particles. And the next process that is involved is the process of leaching. And this leaching is the production of water-soluble inorganic nutrients from the litter that is available on the soil. And this inorganic nutrients settle down in the soil as unavailable salts. And this unavailable salts cannot be used by the plants for consuming energy. So this production is not useful for the plants because this is settling down in the soil as unavailable salts. So we will see about the remaining steps in the next slide. Steps of decomposition part 3. So here we are going to discuss about catabolism. So catabolism is a process where the detritus or the litter is break down into inorganic nutrients, and these inorganic nutrients can be used by the plants for their nutrient consumption. And this process of breakdown into inorganic nutrient is done by organisms such as bacteria and fungi. And going for the next process, that is humification. Humification is the process in which is used for the breakdown of humus. So humus are dark colored amorphous substance that is present in the soil, and this is formed in an accumulated manner. So here the decomposition of this humus is done. So that process is termed as humification, and this humus is also resistant towards microbes. So microbes cannot undergo the decomposition of humus. So here the process of decomposition is slower. Steps of decomposition part 4. So here we are going to discuss about the step, that is mineralization, and this is the final step for decomposition. So here the process involved is the breakdown of humus, that is the dark colored accumulated part of the litter, that is breakdown into inorganic nutrients. So inorganic nutrients ends in the production of minerals. So this the process is termed as mineralization. And these minerals are used by plants for their nutrient consumption, and after which the process of the ecosystem is undergone. Energy flow part 1. So here we are going to discuss about the energy flow in an ecosystem. And the main source of energy is the solar radiation. It is not completely the incident radiation, but it is 50% incident radiation and 50% of PAR. So PAR is otherwise called as photosynthetically active radiation. So this solar radiation provides the energy for the plants, which in turn it is used by the heterotrophs also. So the source for energy is the solar radiation. And the only one ecosystem which is exceptional to this is the deep sea hydrothermal ecosystem, in which there is no source for solar radiation. Here the source for this ecosystem is the energy which is generated by the chemical reaction. So from this chemical reaction, the energy generated is used by the organisms that are in the deep sea hydrothermal ecosystem. Energy flow part 2. So energy in a pyramid or in an ecosystem flows from producers to consumers. So the main source for energy is the solar radiation. The solar energy is absorbed by the plants. In turn, the plant gives the energy for the other organisms which are in the ecosystem. So we know that the 100% of solar radiation consists of 50% incident radiation and 50% of photosynthetically active radiation. But here only 2-10% of the PAR is absorbed by the plant, and this constitutes the total energy in the ecosystem. This 2-10% of the PAR is used by the plants, and the plants in turn give energy to the other heterotrophs in that ecosystem. So energy is required for all the organisms that are in an ecosystem, but this is dependent on the plants and also the solar radiation. So all the organisms in an ecosystem depends on the plants for their food and for the nutrient consumption and for also the energy which is provided by the plant. So this dependence is direct or indirect. So if you take for a grasshopper, it consumes a plant directly. So here it is a direct use of energy. There are also organisms which use the energy of the plants in an indirect way. So this is how the energy flows from the producers to consumers. Energy flow part 3. So this is how we represent the ecosystem in a pyramid. And here it starts from the producers till consumers. So the organisms which does not come under producers, we will term it as consumer, because they consume the energy from the producers. So producers are widely plants. So plants generate energy from the solar energy and also the nutrients present in the soil, and then they give energy for the other organisms. And the consumers include primary carnivores, secondary carnivores, and it may also include tertiary carnivores. So if you take a simple example, the producers as grass, it is taken by goat. So goat comes under the primary carnivores, and the energy for goat is given by the plants. And the next one is secondary carnivores. You can take the example as man. So the energy from the goat is given to man. So here secondary carnivore is man. So in some ecosystem there may also be tertiary consumers or tertiary carnivores. So this is how the pyramid is formed, based on the producers and the consumers that are present in the environment or in the ecosystem. Energy flow part 4. So here we are going to discuss about the producers and the consumers. So who are producers? There are two types of ecosystem. The first one is terrestrial ecosystem and the second one is aquatic ecosystem. So coming for the terrestrial ecosystem, we know that the plants are the green plants are the producers which gives energy for the other organisms in an ecosystem. So coming for the next one, that is the aquatic ecosystem. Here the organisms such as phytoplanktons, algae, or the some other organisms that are living on the water body gives energy for the other organisms for that ecosystem. And coming for the consumers. So consumers gain energy from the producers. So animals depend on the energy from the plant. So this can be direct or indirect. So some organisms depend on the plants directly, and some of the organisms depend indirectly on the plant's energy. So however, the energy for the consumers is given by the producers. And these organisms which comes under the consumers are also called as heterotrophs. Energy flow part 5. So here we are going to discuss about the consumers in detail. So the classification of consumers. There are three types of consumers as we have discussed in the pyramid. It is primary consumer, secondary consumer, and tertiary consumer. So primary consumers are organisms which feeds on the producers directly. So producers, here we can take the plants as an example. So the organisms which feed on plants are termed as primary consumers. For example, we can take it as mouse. So mouse feeds on plants directly. So going for the next one, that is secondary consumers. This feeds on plants which feed on plants. So here we can tell it as the organisms which feed on primary consumers are called as secondary consumers. So for example, we can take it as snakes. So which feed on the mouse. So here this is termed as secondary consumer. And going for the tertiary consumers, the organism that feeds on secondary consumer. So here an example, we can take it as eagle. So eagle feeds on snake. So it consumes energy from the secondary consumer. So likewise, we can classify the primary, secondary, and the tertiary consumer. Energy flow part 6. So here we are going to discuss about the consumers in a short way. So we know that consumers are of primary consumers, secondary consumers. In some cases, there are tertiary consumers also. So primary consumers are herbivores which feeds on plant. So for example, they can be insects or birds which feeds on plant directly. And going for the secondary consumers, it consists of organisms, primary carnivores, and some cases it may also consist of secondary carnivores. So we know that the energy from the plant is consumed by the consumers. So energy from different trophic levels are being passed for the other trophic levels. So energy do not remain constantly. It passes, or in some cases the organism may pull to death. So the dead matter is again used in the breakdown for production of the inorganic minerals which is used by plants. So there also energy is being generated by the process of decomposition. So by using these all things, that is the producers, consumers, and again the decomposition process, a chain or the web is formed because of the interdependency of all the organism which are interacting in the ecosystem. Energy flow part 7. So here we are going to discuss about the detritus food chain. So here the dead organic matter are being converted into inorganic substances, and this is done by the organisms called as decomposers. And decomposers includes organisms such as bacteria and fungi which are present in the dead organic matter for converting this organic matter into inorganic substances. So the organic matter is being decomposed into nutrients which are used by the plants for their nutrient requirement. And this is done by organisms which we term it as saprophytes. So the saprophytes are used in the decomposition of the organic matter into inorganic substances. And this food chain we will term it as detritus food chain. But this saprophytes are not being indicated on an ecosystem pyramid. Energy flow part 8. So we know that the energy flows from the producers till consumers, but the equal amount of energy is not being transferred from the producers till consumers. The energy flow is decreased gradually in different trophic levels, and then the organism will be pulled to death. So after that, this dead organism gives into dead organic matter, which in turn is converted into inorganic nutrients, which is again used by the plants for the next cycle in the ecosystem. So likewise, the ecosystem follows the energy flow in a gradually decreasing way, and then again decomposes to form the energy for the next cycle. Energy flow part 9. So next we are going to discuss about the standing crop. The standing crop is the crop which in each tropic level has a certain mass of living material that are present in a particular time. So in a particular time, if we check for the living organisms that or the mass of living organism in that trophic level, you will get some amount. So that is termed as the standing crop, and this is measured in two ways. First, it can be measured in the number of species that are present in the each trophic level, or it can be about the biomass of living organism that are present in the trophic level. And for calculating about the biomass that is present, biomass of living organism that are present in the trophic level, it can be measured in two ways. The first one is the dry weight, and the second one is the wet weight. So this is how the standing crop of a trophic level is being calculated.